Welcome, everybody. Welcome. Happy December the 1st. Welcome back to The Good Life with Dr. Lori. I am so excited to be here today. Listen, I feel so good right now. I just want to play a little bit of this music. I don't know. I may play the whole song, but I will be right back. I want you to check this out first.
He's so good.
For me, King of Kings, Lord of Lords. Hallelujah. I was super excited to just get started today. That's been my song for the past couple of days. And I tell you what, look, I don't know what mood you in, but if you're feeling it, get you a little bit of CC whinings and just go forward. That whole Alabaster Box album, oh my God, that's just been the bomb for me the past couple of days. So again, guys, woo! Welcome, welcome. I am back. Listen, I have been trying to come back for a little while now. Even yesterday, I had planned to come in yesterday, but again, I wasn't able to do it. So I said, well, look here, maybe I need to just try another day and time and see what happens, because I have some, oftentimes I have a lot of virtual meetings and they come on Wednesdays. And so, you know, but here I am, no complaints, no worries, just super happy to be here. I was just so excited today, but I have a surprise. Guess who is here with me? You guessed it. Overseer Jay Evans.
Hey, all right. Here I am. Live in the well.
All right. Praise the Lord. It is good to have you here. You hear those cheers going forward today? Woo. The folks just letting you know they love you. All right.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. Okay, so we are going to just, well, first of all, happy holidays, happy Merry Christmas, happy belated Thanksgiving, and all of those good things. You know, guys, there's no secret. I love the holiday season. I love to see people happy. I love to see them just being so generous and giving. And I love to see the children just so happy. I can remember when my parents, you know, they would be gearing up for the holiday seasons with the trees and the candy and the fruit and the nuts and the heater just blazing in our living room and the decorations. And, you know, as a child, you would just get so excited. You didn't know what to do. And the closer it got to Christmas, you know, because they was amping it up. And the more closer it got to Christmas, the more excited you became, to the point where you couldn't sleep. You really didn't want to eat. You just was waiting. And of course, you know, we were not saved. And so, you know, they had us waiting for Santa Claus and all of that. Of course, we know now that that was their hard-earned money that they spent at that time during the year to provide for six children in the home. And I'm grateful. Listen to what I'm telling you. I'm grateful to God for that, because life wasn't always easy. But during that time, you know, there was just moments of peace and joy, you know, because we didn't always have that in the home. So I know right now there's probably a lot of believers that feel some type of way about Christmas, and it's a pagan holiday and all of that. You know, there's more paganism weaved into how we live than what we realize. But I'm not going there. We hear about something else today. So again, like I said, happy holidays. And to those of you that are celebrating Christmas, Merry Christmas to you. Overseer Jay Evans.
Yes, ma'am.
You have been on every single Wednesday night, doing the Word with Overseer Jay Evans. Oh, my goodness. I've been on listening to you. And last night, well, the majority of your broadcasts, sometimes they're really deep, and you know, you have to really listen and follow along and come back the next week. But boy, I tell you, last night I was eating at the master's table. Last night the Lord had spoke to me and said I can't even remember the Gentile rule, and I looked that up and just reading about it and everything. Then little did I know that's what you were going to be talking about last night. So that word was so good, and I'm so grateful to you for being so faithful, you know, always coming on and providing that information for people to understand what's going on now and how it relates to the Bible, or shall I say how the Bible relates or lets us know what's going on now, because the Bible has already prophesied about these times. Mm-hmm. Things that are happening are not just happening in America. They're happening around the world. Right, Lord. The same challenges are happening around the world. But we're going to get to the message today, but I do want to encourage you on Wednesdays at 7 p.m., go on Spreaker and pull up The Word with Overseer Jay Evans and start listening so that you can know what's happening now. And not only that, make it a Bible study for you, because it takes you to those places in those books, Daniel and Revelation, and give you this insight and understanding into what's happening in this world. But I'm going to tell you what it does. It causes you to draw closer to the Lord. That's what I told Overseer when he got off yesterday. I said the bottom line is that the only thing that's going to help anybody when the crap hits the fan, yes, as it is doing now, is that you have a right relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. Because if you have that with him, then you have it with the Father. You have it with God the Father. But without Jesus Christ, you do not have a relationship with the Father. You will only meet God when this thing is said and done. And when you meet God, it will not be God the Father. It will be God the Judge, right?
Oh, yeah. Oh yes, absolutely.
And so, so I just wanted to encourage you guys, go in and check out his broadcast, because there's a lot of meat there. Now,
he did your Facebook pages. All of them is there.
So if they want to find you on Facebook, what is it?
Jackie Evans.
Go to Jackie Evans. Now, there's a lot of Jackie Evans. How will they know it's you?
Well, they see my face up here, my picture.
What if they don't know what you look like?
Well, it'll be the Overseer J. Evans.
Okay, so you'll see Overseer J. Evans on there. So go on there, look for him. You know, you can play catch up if you want to, because he has a lot of word for the end times, understanding what's happening now. I mean, I don't know anybody besides him that is looking into these elections, and there's quite a few people, but looking into these elections and understanding what's happening now, what's things are gearing up for, why we, the cell phones, the smart TVs, the tablets. I mean, just go back and listen to all these different shows. You'll learn a lot. So welcome, Overseer Jay Evans. Thank you. Glad to have you here. And hello, God bless you, Tasha. God bless you, God bless you, God bless you. I tell you what, that was such a blessing to set this broadcast up and to see you. And not just Tasha, but to all of you that have been faithfully listening, those of you in India and Africa and Asia, you guys have yet in Europe, you have yet been listening to the broadcast. Even while I was off, you guys have been listening. I just want to tell you, thank you. And if you can, we are back on live. If you can't come into the chat, reach out, you know, let me know that you're here. If not, you can always hit me up on Messenger, Facebook, Dr. Lori Amor, right? Dr. Lori Amor, A'MOR. And from there, you can just hit me up on Messenger and I'll help you get in if you want to come in and sit in. But for now, I just want to tell Tasha, thank you, because you in the house. Woo!
Yeah, because you know I asked about it not long ago, and you said,
I sent you, she changed up her, I think it's Facebook, and I sent it to you, so, you know, you will know that that's her. So, thank you again, Tasha! Woo! Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Bless your name, oh God. Hallelujah. Well, Overseer, let's just go ahead on and jump right in for what we're... I didn't hear that. Did y'all hear that? I didn't hear that. Tasha, we was giving you a celebration clap, and I'm not certain it even... But you know what? Let's move on, because you know we was clapping for you on this side. All right, so let's go ahead on and jump on in today. Guys, we are going to be talking about... Don't be trying to get even with them. Don't be trying to get back at folks that are not treating you right. Right now in your life, whether they've done something to you in the past and you haven't got over it, or whether they're doing something to you currently right now. So I want to give you a little insight that will help you, designed to free you up from trying to get even with people. Because if we be honest about it, Overseer, we like to get even with people. If we feel like they're doing something to us, we have this thing on the inside of us that feels like, oh, okay, I got you. See, we know how to run to God if it's bad or wicked, or if it's a crime against us, if it's a felony against us. And I'm going to hit those type of words in a little bit. We know how to run to God for stuff like that, right?
Oh, yeah.
But it's the little small things, those little foxes. Small foxes that destroy the vine.
Yeah.
It's those things where we get even with people, but we be trying to get even with them. That's what we do. But we don't realize it. We'll put little snide comments on Facebook. You know, we'll say little things to the right person knowing it's going to get back, you know. Mm-hmm. Or we'll say, oh, you know, this right here, this gets me. Oh, I don't have time for people and their foolishness. I'm focused on the Lord, you know. I ain't got time to be dealing with no devils. All of that ain't nothing but just backhand slaps. That's all that is.
Oh, you didn't call me, so I ain't going to call you.
Exactly. Well, we hadn't got there yet. We're about to get there. So I'm just super glad to be talking about this, because the more you talk about things outwardly, the more you hear yourself talk about them, the better chance you have of obeying the word or doing the word when that opportunity arises, mm-hmm. when that situation arises. Because if you just keep it in your mind, when something come up, you might not even remember that this is how God wants you to act. Let me tell you something. What I realize is that we are supposed to be good. We are supposed to be good through and through.
Mm-hmm.
Like a good, crisp, ripe apple. You cut it, boom. You lay it open, it's good. Crisp, clean, no rotten. Then you cut it again. You cut those halves again. Then you cut them again. Every slice of that apple is clean and crisp. There's no rotten parts. There's no worm damage. There's nothing. Every part of that apple is good. Flip it over, right? The outside of the apple look good. That's supposed to be us.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the Bible says there's no good thing in our flesh. But see, we are not people that are of the flesh anymore. We are people that are of the spirit, mm-hmm. right? We live in the spirit. We walk in the spirit. We obey the spirit. We show the spirit in our life to people. When they see us, they don't see us. They see Christ. Is that not how it's supposed to be?
Yeah, exactly.
Now, if I be lying if I said that's how we are every day. Let me break it down even further. I would be lying if I said that's how I am every day.
Every day.
But the more I stay in the word of God, the more I realize we are supposed to be good no matter what.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't mean you won't have times when you got to get on mm-hmm. folks. You got to check them. You got to let them know what's up. But if you're doing that, it's because God told you to do mm-hmm. it. You're not doing it because you're now responding in your flesh. Listen, I remember when I went through with that church. Them folks, whew, they was eating me alive right there in my face, right there in the face of my husband at that time. They were eating me alive. They were calling me unsaved. They were saying all kinds of stuff. I was bewildered. I never heard a Christian talk like that. I would be afraid as a Christian to say somebody's not saved or to call them names. I would be afraid of doing that because you don't know who is God's servant for real.
You don't. That's right.
You can't let them bruises or them worm spots on that apple fool you. Because Amen. You may cut it open and the inside of it is good. A little bit of damage on the outside, but the inside is good. Listen, when they was talking to me and they was saying all of this stuff, that would have been a perfect time for me to get even. I could have said all kinds of stuff, but do you know what I did, Overseer? When that man spoke directly to me, I answered this way. I said, "Yes, sir." Woo! When I look back at that, I was like, what in the world was wrong with me? You know, I am not past having a thought I should have cussed them out. I should have tore that room up, flipped some chairs, some tables, something.
Well, sister, let me tell you what. If I'd have been the husband at that time, it'd have been on.
It'd have been on.
Hey, it'd have been on and popping.
Well, God knew who not to let me in that room.
You told who? Whoa.
But you know what? I was angry and upset that I stood there and didn't say anything and that I answered so nice and politely. But guys, that's the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
I couldn't stay angry for long because that just showed me that was God working in me. And listen, this message we're going to talk about today, this will help you see the true salvation of God working in your life. This will help you see the Holy Ghost really working in your life. This will help you see the Word of God being lived truly in your life. Because sometimes we think we live in the Word of God, we ain't doing nothing. We think because we don't smoke, we don't cuss people out, we don't go to clubs, you know what I'm saying? We don't drink, we don't do this, we think we good. We think we walking with the Lord. But if he pull the covers back on us, he'll show us you ain't bit more doing my word than a man on the moon. You have been delivered from smoking. That's why you don't smoke. You have been delivered from clubbing. That's why you don't go to the club. You have been delivered from drinking. That's why you don't drink. But when it comes down to really walking in my word and loving and doing the things, you ain't doing that. Mm-hmm. You ain't doing that. You will talk about people quick, fast, and in a hurry, the drop of a dime. Mm. Girl, slow down. I had to talk to myself right now. Tasha said I would have to move some furniture. You sound like Overseer right now. She said, I've been learning to ask myself, what will the enemy benefit off of? Yes, ma'am, I hear you. That has helped me think before I act. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Well, let's take it to the Word so we can think even deeper and greater than maybe we have been. Because we know how to act if somebody come for us and it's, I'm going to call it a big thing. Mm-hmm. But let's go to the Word, right? So we're going to be reading from Romans and Peter today. And I'm just going to read these scriptures that deal directly with what we're talking about. Don't try to get even with people. Yeah. Don't try to get back at them. And this right here, what we're talking about today, this deals with even those little, tiny, small things, right? So let me read. I'm going to be coming from Romans 12, verses 17 through 21. I'm going to throw a little Amplified and a little New King James in there. Right? The scripture says in the King James, it says recompense. That word means repay. Repay. Okay? Recompense to no man evil for evil. Now, that's easy to understand.
Yeah, man, yeah.
Somebody do evil to you, don't do evil back to them. Well, where the rubber meets the road is when you get into what that word evil mean. Oh, my God. I'm coming back to that, right? The rest of the scripture says, provide things honest in the sight of all men. In the Amplified Classic, that means take thought for what is honest and what is proper and noble, aiming to be above reproach in the sight of everyone. Let me read this scripture again, okay? So do not repay evil for evil. But take thought for what is honest. Think about things that are honest. Think about things that are proper. Think about things that are noble. You will be aiming to be above reproach. Remember I said we are supposed to be good through and through?
Yeah.
So if someone does evil to you, instead of you responding with thoughts of trying to get evil with them, you're going to have thoughts that are honest and proper and noble. What does, help me out. Think on things that are good. Think honest, on things that are honest. Just.
Yeah. Noble. Yeah, noble.
Right. Yeah. Lovely. Mm-hmm. Right. So this is who we
good
are.
Report.
So you telling me, overseer, somebody coming for me or somebody treating me bad or treating me wrong or whatever the case may be, I respond with thoughts of truth, honesty. I'm responding with good thoughts, child. Let me tell you, talking about living the word of God.
Oh,
this
man.
Right here.
That's it.
This is going to let you know if you're really saved.
Oh, my God.
Let me tell you what this word evil means, because we're going to go on. I'm going to read all the rest of those scriptures. Let me just read this, and then I'm going to come back. Let me just read it. This was so good to me. Like, even now, I need to just slow down. Let me read it again. Okay, I'm going to read it from the New King James so I can read it all the way through. Repay no one evil for evil. Have regard for good things in the sight of all men. If it is possible, as much as depends on you. Listen, whatever you can do in this situation that is good, that's going to cause it to be peaceful, you need to do this. As much as depends on you, live peaceably with all men. Beloved, sweetheart, baby cakes, sugar dumplings, do not avenge yourselves, but rather, listen to what the word says, give place to wrath. The King James says, dearly beloved, avenge not yourselves, but rather give place unto wrath. For as it is written, vengeance is mine. I will repay, saith the Lord. Saith the Lord. You make room for my wrath, for my anger, for my discipline. You make room for that. I'll repay them. See, what we do, we'll do these little things where we respond back to the person. Once we did that, we cut God out of doing anything.
Yes.
We cut him out of doing anything. Let me go on back to the New King James, verse 19. Beloved, do not avenge yourselves, but rather give place to wrath. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. For this reason, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him a drink. For in so doing, you will heap coals of fire on his head. Verse 21 says, do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. That last scripture tells you point blank that in the midst of evil coming at you, being done to you, you respond with good. And by responding with good, you have made room for God's wrath for him to deal with them. So you wonder why it seems like people just keep getting away with stuff. You wonder why it seems like they keep getting over and ain't nothing happening. The reason why is because we're running our mouth. We're talking about them. We trying to be slick and sneaky. We're putting up these posts and all of that because we're cutting God out of dealing with them.
Mm-hmm.
We're cutting them out of it. And that's what we do not need to do. Now, I want to go to this word evil so you can understand. The word evil in Greek, it deals with bad, wicked, maleficent, which means damage, failure, harm, injury, or with malfaction. Malfaction means crime or felony. So we understand stuff like that. We understand if somebody come for us and it's really bad what they're doing. We know how to get out of the way and let God handle it because we don't want to go to jail.
Mm-hmm.
We don't want to do, we don't want to, they hurt us or wrecked our car. We don't want to get out of the car and go over there and beat them down because we know at the end of the day, we're going to be in some major trouble. So we know how to get out of the way with stuff like that. We know how to run to God. We know how to cry and, you know, turn up for the Lord, if you will. We know how to do that. But it's those little small things. And how I knew this is when the Lord had gave me this, that word evil kept sticking out with me. And I said, let me go. Apparently, I don't fully understand or grasp evil, mm-hmm. right? I understood the bad and the wicked and the maleficence. I understood that. And the crime and the felony. I understood that. But let's go a little further. Inside of this word evil is the word ill, not sickness or disease, that not that ill, but acting badly or naughty. So you got somebody acting like childlike, you know, acting kind of childish like in your life, but it's directed towards you. You find yourself dropping down to their level, acting the same way, giving them a little dose of what they gave you. Now, you might not even do it directly to them.
Well, that's something.
You may not do it directly to them. You may go on Facebook and do it. You may go on Instagram and do it. You may tweet about it and do it, right? Or you may tell your friends in hopes that they gonna let them know how you feel, right? But what God wants you to do, even if they're acting childish or naughty or badly or whatever the case may be, he wants you to respond with good. It's like somebody hit me inside the head right now. You want me to act good. Of course he do. Why? Because that's him on the inside of you responding to evil. God does not respond to evil with evil. That's not how he get down. There's no evil in him. The scripture says there is no darkness in him. Right? So he doesn't respond like that. Here's another one. Mischievous. We know what that means. We think about that when we think of children being sneaky and doing stuff, right? Don't even think about children. Adults are the same way. So you got somebody in your life and they start acting mischievous. The word mischievous means, and these words are really funny to me. So they start acting irregular. That means that they're not acting the way they normally act. So now they're acting irregular. You can't put your finger on it, but you know something ain't right. You know it. You can feel it. You discern it, but you don't know what it is. Instead of responding to their irregularity in the relationship, instead of you acting like that, giving them the same thing back, you come back and you be the same way that you was. You continue to be good. Oh, it gets deeper than that. Here's three words that kind of make you, you know, it's a little funny. The word is straggly, unruly, and snatchy. Right? I looked those words up. I'm like, Lord, what in the world is this? But when you think about it, we have words in this culture that she acted all stuck up, or she acted all bougie, or acting all crabby, or, you know, we got these words that mean the same thing. It just means that this person in your life, they act in some type of way. And the way that they're acting, it makes you feel some type of way. And when you get to feeling some type of way, you want to now start acting some type of way. You want to start dealing with them the way that they deal with you. But see, you don't think about this being anything bad or ungodly, but guess what? He says, don't repay evil for evil. So that means that your response would equally be classified as evil. Mm-hmm. So now you're acting straggly, snatchy, and unruly. We do it all the time with our husbands. We do it all the times with our wives. Am I telling the truth? Right? Somebody will say something. You will say something, or I'll say something, and I'm just using husbands and wives in general. And it's like, what's wrong with you? Why are you acting like that? But see, now I'm going to match Whatever it is you just did, I'm going to match that. So now you acting crabby or snatchy or scraggly, you acting like that, then I'm going to match that. I'm going to give it back to you, right?
Mm.
No, that is not how I'm supposed to act. Because you might be acting like that and the core of that may be evil. It may be evil. You might be being mean or nasty to me. I'm not supposed to match that because now I'm repaying evil for evil. When God says, do not do that.
Ooh.
What I want you to do is I want you to come back with love. I want you to come back with honesty and nobility. And I want you to come back in a way that represents you being good, which is you representing me. Now, if there's a real issue, because it might be that this person was just having a bad day or a bad moment and it ain't got nothing to do with you. But when you allow God to deal with it, he may deal with that person and they come back and say, you know what? I'm so sorry that I was acting all irritable like that. I had this happen and that happen. See, you didn't know all of those details. But they come back and they explain that to you. They tell you. And now, you know, the love is able to continue to flow as it was. But what happens is you start matching that irritation. And when you start matching that irritation, now you got this. The other person's now even more irritated because they don't understand what you mad about. But they didn't even recognize that's how they was acting. So now it's a mess in the home. And both of you need God. When if just one person would have operated in love and kindness,
then
none of this would have happened. But now this right here, this Tasha says, all this message right here, you was on on my porch now. You all in my house. I'm not mad, though. You know, praise the Lord.
Like scripture, the soft answer, turn away wrath, or just if a person is speaking loud, you speaking soft, they'll like, really loud, they'll come down. You know, that's a great message. It's a good
eye-opener. Well, it to the point, Overseer, where I walked away saying, am I really living the word of God? Because I can list everything I do not do, but am I actively living the word of God? Or do I just sit and read the word, feel good, walk around feeling good, but in my living this life here on earth, in this body, with this mind, am I really living the word of God? Am I good? If you cut me open, are you going to see good? Or are you going to see just flesh that's docile?
Mm.
I know, but this is what put, Tasha, you said I was on your porch, now I'm in your house. Woo-woo! Listen to this that's coming up. This is what got me. This is what part of the word evil in Greek means. It means spiteful. Spiteful. We know what that means, spiteful. But let me walk through some of the words for spiteful. Stubborn.
Mm.
You know that you should do good. You know that you should do right. You know that you shouldn't be angry and upset and doing it. You know it. But you won't do it because you're stubborn. What does the Bible say? Stubborn, being stubborn is as witchcraft.
Mm-hmm.
Now that's some scary stuff right there. So you operate when you're being stubborn and you will not apologize and you will not do anything. He said, as much as it is in you, as much as you have to do with this, live peaceably with all men. So that means that if you have the ability to go and apologize and make this right, but you refuse to do it.
You know, the thing is, like you say, I mean, when we say all is all. That's wife, children, all.
Everybody,
but be like, well, I ain't know. You pick and choose.
Mm. Mm.
But all is all.
I can name three people right now that I am not speaking to, But I have the ability to go and apologize and make it right, whether they did it or not. It doesn't matter. I am to make peace with all men. This is what I'm talking about. This right here lets you know if you live and save for real. This lets you know. Because if you can't make it right, but you have the ability, you have it in you to do it, but you refuse to do it, you are stubborn, you are spiteful, and you are operating in witchcraft. Oh, my God. Lord, have mercy, Jesus. See, we don't fully understand. Headstrong. Opinionated. Well, I understand this right here, but you know the Bible says that this and that. But what you're using the scriptures to do is to stay stubborn. You're using the scriptures to continue on in the way. But then we have these other little things. Well, you know, I know God don't want me to just take somebody abusing me. Well, there are scriptures that says that we are to turn the other cheek. If someone smite us, we are to turn the other cheek. Are you still saying God don't want you to take somebody treating you this way or that way? He don't want you to take it. But what he wants you to do is not respond to them. Not repay evil for evil. He want you to get out of the way. Mm-hmm. And the way you get out of the way is you remain in a peaceful state. You remain in a kind place. You remain in a thoughtful place, right? The thoughtful place is, God, please, you got to help me. I don't want to say anything. I don't want to do anything. I want to do what you're telling me to do. You told me to make way for your wrath. God, I'm asking you, hold me, keep me, help me not to respond, to be nice, to be kind. You could be talking to God about your spouse. You could be talking to God about your kid. You just got a call from the school talking about your child and their behavior. And you want to go in there and snatch a knot in them. And God is saying, no, that is not what I want you to do. I want to deal with them. You make room for me to deal with them.
Oh, yeah.
Right? But now, if you've been living like the devil, and now they at school acting like the devil, let me deal with you first, because you are the problem. You are the problem. Opinionated. So it's amazing how we can have all of these opinions about how we feel like God want us to, he don't want us to take this or take that or do this or do that. No, and it doesn't matter. If it's your spouse, your child, a stranger, they do something to you, he wants you to come to him either way. Open up the door for him to be able to do this. Now, I know there are people that are extreme. And they say, so you telling me if somebody break in your house, God just wants you to just stand back and let them do what they doing? No, we have been given a law. Mm-hmm. If someone break in your house, they have every intention of harming you, doing whatever. That's against the law. Okay. Yeah. And the law has provided things for you to be able to do. And we honor the law before God, which is why if the speed limit say 55 and you're doing 65, you are breaking the law. And God does not honor that. Now, we do it all the time. We think God don't pay attention to stuff like that. He has mercy on us many times, mm-hmm. you know. But understand, so if someone breaks into your house or they assault you, snatch you or whatever, you got a gun on you, you got a knife on you, you got whatever on you, use it. Mm-hmm. Use it. Of course, you could be praying, but the law does not allow for anybody to do anything to you and you can't defend yourself, mm-hmm. okay? Here's the thing, though. When all of that's said and done, you know how you want to hate and you want to kill them if you can? That's the area there. God does not want you doing that, because that's going to kill you. It will kill you spiritually and it will affect you naturally, right? So if you have to defend yourself, by all means, defend yourself in a physical situation. You got to do what you got to do. Do what you got to do. But if someone's running off at the mouth, talking to you, saying stuff, you don't have to come back and say a word. The only time you say something is if God gives you something to say. And at this point right here, a calm will come over you. All you got to do is go back and look at Jesus. A calm will come over you. And when the things start coming up out of your mouth, it will put them in their place without you having to do anything. Those words will check them, put them in their place. And what's coming to me right now is when Jesus was writing on the ground, when these people were around him and they started talking about what the Torah said, and this woman needs to be stoned because she was caught in the act of adultery. And, you know, they weren't there talking all nice and kind. They wanted to see some action. They wanted to see Jesus do something to her. They wanted to be able to, they had stones. They was ready. They was ready to bust her up. Jesus was writing, and when he spoke to them, he was calm. Yes. And he said, the one that's without sin, you cast the first stone. Go ahead. Go ahead. They was convicted. They were cut to the core, and they walked away. They left. Now, there may be a time when somebody may do something to you physically, and the Lord say, don't do nothing. He said, don't do nothing. Don't do nothing at all. Somebody may shove you. They may slap you. They may do something. He said, don't do anything at all.
Yeah. That's right, yeah.
Because I'm telling you now, if he tell you not to move, he has something far greater that's going to deal with them than you could even imagine. You slapping them back, that's just a fight. Mm-hmm. But he has something far greater. Right? Now, I can't tell you in every single situation what God will do. I can only tell you what he's given me to say right now. So for those of you that may be in a struggle, that's having a struggle, and somebody coming for you and they doing stuff or they acting some type of way, please pray. Please ask God, Lord, how do I make room for your wrath? Because if I don't fight back, I got this situation. If I fight back, I got this situation. You need wisdom from the Lord. And listen, God will use situations like this to draw you closer to him. And sometimes he will not allow you to do anything because he sends somebody bigger, greater, and grander to fight your battle, right? And they will take care of that issue. Listen, he sent David to take care of the Philistines.
Yes, he did.
He sent little David to take care of what an army could not do. They was afraid.
Ooh.
They had no idea how they was going to deal with that situation. They had got together and they was going to try to deal with it themselves. But God sent David. And David did not come with all of that gear on, all of that armor and all that. Boy came with a slingshot and five smooth stones. So if you can't handle what's going on, God, send me a David. Send me somebody to take care of this for me because I can't do it.
Nah.
Lord have mercy, Jesus. Still talking about spiteful, willful, malicious. Some people are just straight up and down evil. They just evil. They're wicked in their thought. They don't do anything. They're very calculating. Very calculating. And they hold grudges. And they wait for the right time to set you up or to trip you up. But this may take years. They may be sitting on it, working on it, waiting for that opportunity. And it might be a moment to just slander you before somebody that's looking to hire you or looking to give you something. You don't know, but they're malicious. Let that not be named among any of God's people. We cannot be people like this. Honorary. The word honorary means low down. Low down. And we use words like that. We say, man, that joker was low down. Can you believe what he did? Can you believe? And see, here's stuff like, let's say you're married and your spouse cheat on you. You might think in your mind, you cheated on me. You opened the door for this. I can cheat on you. No, that was evil, what they did. And it's evil if you respond the same way. Yeah. See, you mess around and you respond like that. You're an attractive, good-looking person. You're not going to have no problem getting anybody. But you might, because you're doing this in a spiteful way, you're the one that's going to get out of here and you're going to catch something. You're the one that's going to get out of here. If you're a male, you're going to get that woman pregnant. You're the one that's going to get out of here and you're going to end up in a situation whatever she got going on in her life, now it's a part of your life, or whatever he got going on. You got all this spiritual crap that's in the background that you don't know about, but when you become intimate with them, then that mess is now in your life. Mm. It's not as easy as you think. Oh, well, they cheating on me and they out here messing around and carrying on. I'm not going to stand for this. I'm going to get me somebody. Okay, yeah, you're going to get that. And then you're going to bring all this other stuff in your life. Ooh. Your best bet is to find out, God, what do you want me to do? Listen, I didn't even know that my husband at that time was having an affair on me. I didn't know it. I was standing in the window one day, overseer, looking out the window, and I had this overwhelming feeling to get in the car and drive. And I did. I got in the car. Never had a thought of this man doing nothing. Got in the car, drove up to the stop sign, and you can go straight, left, or right. I turn left. And I drive down the street. You can keep driving or turn left or right on any of these streets. I go all the way to the end. I turn left again. Now, I'm just driving. I turn left again, and then I turned left again as if I was going home. I'm driving down the road. Bam, I see my ex-husband pulled up, backed up into somebody's yard at their house, almost where you couldn't really see the vehicle, you know. And I slowed down, and I saw him out there, and I just kind of started laughing. I started laughing because the reason why I was laughing is because I was just driving.
Oldest man with direction.
Yes. And so I went on home. Needless to say, the marriage did not last long after that. And it wasn't even that particular thing that caused it to go left. As far as I'm concerned, it was not that, right? But it did end up leaving. And then later I found out through some of the neighbors and stuff what was really going on. Now, what if I had responded the same way? Mm. Like, you know, I was fairly young, a nice looking woman, didn't have no problems getting no man. I could have easily saw him and laughed and then thought, ooh, so now this is my opportunity right here, you know. Mm-hmm. But you can't respond like that. You have to find out, God, what you want me to do. Now, later on, a pastor, a man of God, maybe he was a pastor at that time, a man of God, he met me and him, and he was standing there looking at us, talking to us. And then later on, that man said to me, God gonna move your husband if he don't get right. That's what he said to me point blank. Do you hear me? He said that. Don't know nothing about this man. Don't know anything about anything that's going on. But this pastor said to me, God's gonna move your husband if he don't get right. He said the same thing later on. He said point blank, God gonna move your husband. Look, I didn't divorce my husband. My husband left me. Yeah. He left me. I was like, wow. But now I know some folks listening is gonna have an attitude because they're gonna feel like, well, you was never supposed to get married again and this and that right there. Take it up with God. But listen, had that not happened, I would not have the amazing man that I have in my life.
Well, praise
the Lord. That has showed me
She was Bill.
A man that has showed me of how a man is supposed to be, how a man is supposed to take care of the family, how a man is supposed to provide for you, how a man is supposed to minister the word of God to you, how a man is supposed to pray for you, how a man is supposed to be the head of the household, and how that is really on him, and he's responsible for that, and he's accountable to God for that. I never seen that before, but I seen it. I have it, and I thank God for it. So it pays not to be spiteful, right? Here's just one more. Obstinance. Well, it's really more than one. Obstinance, meaning to be testy or touchy. This is the one that gets us in trouble as spouses. Again, your spouse got a little attitude. They're feeling a little touchy or testy. And you respond back to them the same way. Overseer, I got some folks in my life right now. And one person, you know, I was kind of upset with, you know, our relationship because it just wasn't firing. And, you know, I got a little upset about that and said it, right? The end result was a person, like, just completely and absolutely pulled away from me. I apologized as best I could, heartfelt, because that was my initial issue, is that, you know, I was feeling bad about the relationship. It's like, what's going on? What's happening? But now they pulled away from me. And then I apologized and everything. And I had an expectation of us, you know, coming back together, because I was only upset that, you know, our relationship was not firing the way that it was. Well, that, my expectation was, it didn't come to pass. Mm-hmm. We did not come back together, and we are further apart now than we ever were. And I found myself getting upset and feeling like I just want to get even. If that's how you're going to treat me, you're going to get the same thing. And I remember feeling that when a long time ago with my dad, I felt like my dad wasn't close to me. And I had called him. I was still trying to connect and reach out. And I had called him. And he said, "Who is this?" After just a couple of seconds, he said, "Who is this?" I said, "Annette." And he was like, "Oh, okay. All right, then. Talk to you later." And he got off the phone. I slammed that phone down. I was not saved at this time. But I slammed that phone down and I said, "I don't care if he die. I will never, ever call him again." Mm-hmm. That's how I felt. If you're going to act like that towards me, you're going to get the same thing. Right? And I kept that and I held that for many, many years. And, of course, being born again and everything, God softened my heart, so I connected back with him. He didn't change. He still treated me the same way. But right before he died, in June, somewhere around 25th, right before he died, he was on the phone, and he said these words. He said, "You know I love you. I love you." And I'm on the phone like, what in the world? Because it was real. It was real. It was in-depth. It was heartfelt. It was real. And I didn't really know what to do with it, but I accepted it. And I said, yeah, right? Do y'all know this man died not too long after he said those words to me? Not too much longer. But I was okay. Even though I didn't have that kind of relationship with him, I had still lived a good life. I had still did okay. I had made some bad choices, of course. You know, you're going to make bad choices when you don't know any better, especially when you're not saved, right? But when he left this earth, I found peace in the fact that he didn't know he was going to die, but I found peace in the fact that at the end of the day,
that's it,
he knew that he really did love me. And he gave me that as a gift before he left here. So that kind of canceled out. That was like a but. And you know a but, B-U-T, cancels out everything that was said before it.
Yeah.
That was like a but, right? Mm-hmm. So that meant that anything he had done prior to that was canceled out, right? So I have peace and joy in my mind when it comes to my dad. Now, I still will use the stories because I want to be able to help other people that may be going through a struggle with a parent. And they need to know that love anyway, because you don't know what God is going to do. When I was full of hate and didn't have anything to do with him, God couldn't do anything. There was nothing he could do, right? And right now, I sense I need to talk about marriages. Somebody in their marriage right now, you're feeling kind of hopeless because your marriage, you're going through, and right now it feels really bad. You feel like y'all not going to make it. Y'all going to end up in divorce. And, I mean, it's really bad right now, and I sense that it is. But this is what I want to tell you. God wants you to stand down. He wants you to humble yourself. He wants you to let your spouse know you do not want your marriage to end. You do not want to be apart from them. You want to do whatever you can to make it right. Let them know that you are willing to forgive. Let them know that you're willing to change. You got to do whatever you got to do. But if you don't want this marriage to end, you have got to right now make room for God to be able to come in and heal and deliver. You cannot keep praying and asking God to help, 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 but then you're still running your mouth. You're still doing stuff. You're still acting nasty. You're not speaking. You're not cooking. You're not doing anything. You're not coming home, man. You're finding other stuff to do because you don't want to hear your wife. But you know what? You have an opportunity. You can buy some flowers. You can come home. You can say this is a peace offering. I would like for us to get along. I would like for us to have peace. You got to do whatever you got to do. You got to hear this word. You got to hear it right now because now is the time. You have got to strike while the iron is hot. You got to move while God is telling you to move, because that means that the person on the other end, they will respond. They may not act like it. Their pride is in the way. They may not act like it, but when they're out of your sight, they're battling, they're struggling, they're trying to get out from under that pride. And you know it's not easy. So do not give up. But yes, the marriage is rough right now, but it does not have to end. God can turn this thing around. This is a fiery furnace. He can turn it around and bring this thing and make this an absolute blessing in the body of Christ, to where you can use this to help people to be set free. So that's your word. That's your prophetic word that you need to change right now to save this marriage. Amen.
Amen. Praise
Amen.
God.
Amen. All right. So, you know, wow, I forgot how fast. I forgot how fast.
That was a great word, though.
These broadcasts go. But listen, I want you to go back and read Romans 12, verses 17 through 21. And also add to that 1 Peter 3, 8 through 12. But go ahead on and read past 12, because this will help you. It will help build you up to be able to do what God is saying. Don't try to get even with anybody. And I kid you not, when we get off this broadcast, we don't know what will happen or what's going to try to come our way to try us for this word. But I will tell you this. Let me pray right now. Father, in the name of Jesus, you have spoken to at least three people I know, Tasha and myself and Overseer Jackie Evans. You have spoken to us, Lord, about not getting even with anyone, no matter what, whether it's a big thing, a great thing, a small thing, an insignificant thing. Lord, you have spoken to us. You have told us what you want us to do, to not repay evil for evil and to make room for you to be able to come in and deal with whatever the situation may be. God bless you, Dr. Charles Brown. Thank you and welcome. It's good to see you. And so, Lord, we continue to pray that even after we are off this broadcast, having heard this word, God, help us to hide this word in our heart so that we won't sin against you. So no matter when a testy or a touchy or a crime, a felony come up, Lord, we can still do what the word says. Help us, Lord. We ask you to keep us from evil. Keep us from evil. And help us to just continue to walk upright before you. We give you praise. We give you glory. We give you honor. And in Jesus' name, we give you thanks. Amen. Pastor Dr. Charles Brown says, amen. I'm a living, married man that God can turn. Oh, okay. So he's a witness. That's what he's saying. He's a witness that God can turn your marriage for the much, much, much better. Amen. Thank you. You came in right on time for that, you know, and people need to know. So if you guys need someone that can maybe help you or minister to you at this time because you don't know anybody, if you go on Facebook and you look up Charles E. Brown, Charles E. Brown, you can reach out to Dr. Charles Brown.
Because he's and always talking about know. Marriage and,
exactly.
And building a good exactly. marriage relationship.
Dr. Brown, can you put in your, because sometimes people don't do well in marriage because they're not really hearing about, you know, things to help them in marriage. Can you put in your podcast name so they can also go and look at listen to your podcast on marriage? Tasha said, me too. Tim and I can vouch for that as well. You know, I thank God because, I mine crashed and burned, but I can tell you there is life on the other side.
Amen.
I can tell you there is life after divorce, and that's the only thing I will minister to people on about marriage. So I'm just going to get, okay, there we go. Thank you for putting that in. Prevailing Faith Ministries on Spreaker. So it's on this same platform. Please go if you are struggling with your marriage. And listen, this is to my friends in India. This is to my friends in Africa, my friends in Australia. This is to my friends in Canada. This is to my friends in every Asian country or nation. Listen to me. Go. If you are struggling in your marriage, you need help. You need something to encourage you. Go and listen to Prevailing Faith Ministries on this same platform. Put that in. Prevailing Faith Ministries. If you're just listening to this podcast, but you want to see those words, pull this up and look at what the comments in the chat, and you'll be able to see it. Prevailing Faith Ministries. Look it up and listen, because the more you get fed on marriage, yes, the better you will be, right? That's one thing my husband and I do all the time. We stay in the word together. We pray together. We minister to one another. And the reason why we do that, because we know outside of God, marriage ain't no joke. Mm-hmm. It is no joke. And when we came together, both being believers, being people of God, one of the things we ask God is that he keep us to death do us part.
Absolutely. Amen.
Y'all know what that means, right? The only way this marriage is going to end, somebody going to die.
Absolutely.
That's the only way. And that it sounds funny. It sounds funny. But when you ask God, Lord, keep us to death do us part.
And then if I die, I'm still taking care of
him. I love that about
you. My responsibility is still taking care of you, even in death.
You are so awesome. You are so awesome. Okay, guys, we're here in Georgia, Columbus, Georgia. Y'all have a fantastic rest of the day. And Dr. Lori is back. I'm super glad that Overseer Jay Evans was able to pop in with me,
yes,
my friend. And thank you, Dr. Brown and Tasha for coming in, and to the rest of you guys that are listening outside of the chat. God bless you. We love you. Don't forget, do not repay evil for evil. No matter what they do, if they stop speaking to you, speak anyway. If they don't call you, call anyway. If they don't do all the stuff they used to do, you keep doing what you was doing. You don't act like they do. I tell you what, you just open up room for God to deal with it.
Amen.
All right? All right. Pastor Brown said, amen. but we ain't dying early. Bless it. No, sir, we're not. We already done counted up the cost of that.
We're
going to go ahead on and look. Might as well just live right if you want to get your time in on this earth.
Right.
You want that longevity?
Longevity.
You got it. Look, you only going to get that through the Lord. Amen. I agree with that. Thank you for bringing that to our
attention. Dr. Charles Brown.
We ain't trying to get up out of here early. We trying to make a difference in this world for other folks to be saved. All right. We love you guys. Y'all be blessed. And go ahead on and have you a CC whining kind of day. Get that music, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Man, she pumped me up so big about Jesus. Woo! All right, guys. Love you. We out.
He's so good. Oh.